Hi, I'm Kara Speck, host of today's Northwestern Medicine Facebook Live. National Infertility Awareness Week is April 22nd through the 28th, but here at Northwestern, we're kicking things off a little bit early. With me are Dr. Eve Feinberg, who is the Medical Director of Northwestern Medicine Fertility and Reproductive Medicine in North Suburban Highland Park, and Dr. Angela Lawson, a psychologist who works specifically with fertility patients. Well, they are our special guests today. You can find their FRM TV, that's Fertility and Reproductive Medicine TV, every month on their Facebook page. That's facebook.com/Northwestern Medicine FRM. And we'll have a link to that on this Facebook page. So they do a live show every month, so you should definitely tune into that. But today they will be talking, because it's Fertility Week, on the broader Northwestern channel. So today our topic is myths. These two will be helping us sort fact from fiction about fertility and infertility. We'd like to hear most from you. I have a few myths I'd like to throw out, or maybe they're facts. We'll find out. But we would like to hear most from all of you, our patients, or anyone interested in fertility topics. So write your questions below, and we will try to answer as many as possible in the next 30 minutes. Be warned, 30 minutes goes really fast, so if you have a question, definitely ask it. Sooner rather than later. If you would like to learn more about Northwestern Fertility and Reproductive Medicine or to make an appointment, visit fertility.nm.org or call 312-695-7269. Okay, final reminders, turn the volume way up just in case you can't hear us. And this does not substitute for medical advice for specific medical problems from an actual doctor. So reach out to your doctor, but we do have two doctors here right now, so feel free to post your questions below. All right, the first fertility fact or myth is one that I see all the time in all these Facebook moms groups I'm in, which is if you were trying to get pregnant, you should eat pineapple, and not just like pineapple chunks or rings, but the actual core. So can you talk about that?
Yeah. So that's a myth. I can tell you that right off the bat. I'm not sure where the source data comes from that. Yeah. I don't know if you know the origin of it, but I tried looking into our literature just to say, like, is there something that I'm missing here? And I couldn't find a single published study that substantiates the idea of eating pineapple core in order to conceive.
So I have searched as well to try and find any research that supports that. And I think where it came from, there's
dull pineapple.
That would be sneaky. No, there's a nutrient in the core, mostly in the core of a pineapple, that is really driving this myth. But what's really interesting is there are discussions online about how the core can both help you get pregnant and can cause miscarriage. So it's a double whammy either way. But ultimately, no research supports that eating pineapple cores can get you pregnant. But it does make you feel like you're doing something, feel like you're taking control of something that you don't have a whole lot of control over, which is why it's probably gotten so popular as a myth.
Is there any, are there any foods you could eat that might help with this? Or just eat healthy fruits like pineapple?
I mean, for patients who are markedly overweight, mm-hmm. diet has been shown, so diet calorie restriction, decrease in weight by 5 to 10% has been shown to reduce inflammation, which may then in turn increase implantation rates, or for patients who have things like polycystic ovarian mm-hmm. syndrome where they don't ovulate regularly and predictably, in that specific instance, some dietary changes like whole fat, dairy, reduction in carbohydrates, increase in protein have been shown to increase ovulation rates. But in the arena of IVF specifically, right. where pineapple core is thought to enhance embryonic implantation, there's no food to date that's been shown to increase the likelihood that that embryo will stick.
Okay, we actually already have a couple questions and comments. So Sandra says, great work, and thumbs up. Megan says, I'm curious, are there any myth-type statements that are actually true? Anything men and women should keep in mind?
Oh gosh, that's a good question, because most of the things we hear are not true. I don't know what, I can't think of anything that would be assumed to be a myth that is actually true. The biggest one that people talk about when it comes to what they think is true is about stress and whether or not stress affects fertility. We actually have a great deal of research. We know that stress does not cause infertility. It does not cause miscarriage. But people talk about it like it's true. So many people believe that it's true. And it's actually a myth.
Okay, but that actually plays into one of the ones that I've heard, which is if you just get drunk one night, have a few cocktails, relax and have sex, that this will. Been trying for a couple months and it hasn't worked. Have like a fun night out with
depends
your partner.
Depends on who you have sex with. So if your partner has a low sperm count and you have sex with somebody else, But no, I mean, I think that I hear that every day in my practice, and I think probably one of the most frustrating things is I think that statement tends to put blame on the patient. Like, it's your fault, you're too stressed out.
Right.
Relax, take a chill pill, take a vacation, adopt a baby, and you'll get pregnant. And I think that's really hurtful. I mean, I think that you're effectively, in not so many words, saying to the patient, like, you're causing your own infertility. Whereas multiple well-validated studies have really shown that there's no impact of stress on fertility.
And I think you know, we do have a good amount of research which shows that these types of relaxing activities, whether it's getting drunk, going on vacation, adopting a baby, and having a baby, don't cause any change in rates of pregnancy. At the same time, couples who go on vacation, have sex, adopt a baby, and continue having sex, if you keep having sex, you probably don't have a 0% chance of conceiving. And so there will be some subset of couples that if you keep having appropriately timed intercourse, will go on to conceive. But people use those as examples of, see, I adopted a baby and had a baby, and they don't talk about, you know, the 95% of other couples who adopted, continued having sex and didn't have a baby.
Well, or the fact that it's usually by the time somebody tries to get pregnant for a year, fails fertility treatment, goes on to adopt, you're talking about anywhere from a 3 to 5 year time period. When we look at fertility rates, we look at fertility rates on a monthly basis, on an annual basis, and we know, as you had said earlier, we know that there is a cumulative likelihood of getting pregnant, even for couples who are, and I don't like infertile, but we think of it as subfertile, their time to conception may just be extraordinarily long, but many, many couples will eventually get pregnant. And so the problem is that that eventually tends to happen after so many years that people have moved on. They've purchased homes or they've adopted. And I think there's a tendency to link that as a coincident event, but it's not. It's just a temporal event. You give it enough time and it probably will happen. But I think realistically, who wants to wait 7, 8, 9, 10 years to have a baby? You want a baby yesterday. And so fertility treatment helps to shorten that time to conception.
All right, we have a question from Samantha. And Samantha, this isn't or anybody watching, this isn't actually like a myth for a fact question, but it is a fertility question.
Okay.
So while they're up here, definitely feel free to write in. So she wants to know, hello, what is the difference between Clomid and letrozole?
Letrozole,
good question.
So Clomid and letrozole are both pills, so oral agents that are given for ovulation induction. They both work through the same mechanism. So in order to ovulate, what has to happen is your brain turns on a signal of the hormone FSH, and that goes to the ovary, and the FSH signals the ovary to grow follicles in order to have ovulation occur. So Clomid works by binding to the brain and telling the brain directly, kick out more FSH, and letrozole works peripherally. So it works in the side tissue, so not at the level of the brain directly. It prevents the conversion of androgens to estrogen, so it's called an aromatase inhibitor because it inhibits the enzyme aromatase. So it decreases the amount of estrogen that's in the body. The brain senses that estrogen is decreased, and then the brain works by turning on FSH. So the way that the two drugs work effectively is the same. They both increase the output of FSH by the brain to stimulate the ovary, but the mechanism is different. And so the way that we use them is different. Aromatase inhibitors are much more effective for women that have polycystic ovarian syndrome, and that's our drug of choice for women who have PCOS for ovulation induction. But Clomid is much more effective for couples that have unexplained infertility, and success rates are higher in unexplained infertility.
Okay. Kimberly wants to know, and this relates to something that I just read before I came in here on people.com. Kimberly wants to know, at what age is it too late to try to have a baby? And the story I read is that the actress Rachel Wise, 48, reveals she's expecting her first child with husband Daniel Craig, who himself is 50. So is this too late? I mean, I guess 48 is not too late, but can you talk a little bit about age and fertility?
Yeah, so even, they're two separate questions.
Yeah.
So how old is too old to carry a baby? The American Society for Reproductive Medicine, our national guidelines, state that if a woman is in good health, that it is permissible to carry a pregnancy up until the age of 55. That gives our maternal fetal medicine specialists probably a heart attack. We at Northwestern think that probably up until the age of 52 is safe to carry a baby. The question of at what age does natural fertility end, we think that the end of reproductive, like the ovaries in terms of oocyte competence or the ability to have a baby with your own eggs, IVF has never been successful in somebody beyond the age of 46 using their own eggs. So all of these celebrities that have babies beyond the age of 46 either got pregnant naturally, they did IVF with their eggs when they were much younger and they either froze their eggs or froze their embryos, or they're using egg donors. And egg donors are young, healthy, 21 to 29-year-old women who come in and donate eggs for couples that are unable to get pregnant. And so while I cannot speak to any celebrity in terms of how they achieve pregnancy, the majority of these pregnancies are really conceived with the use of egg donors.
All right, and congratulations to them, by the way. If they're watching, feel free to write in a question. Amanda wants to know, and this relates to this question actually, is there a certain age threshold you think women need to freeze their eggs if they want to have kids later in life? Is there an age cutoff you recommend a woman try natural conception? That's a good question.
Yeah, that's a great question. So the literature really suggests that 36 is optimal for freezing eggs because from a cost efficacy standpoint, that you're gonna have a higher likelihood of actually needing to use those eggs at 36. I will tell you this is hotly debated in our field. Mm-hmm. I personally feel that it's much better for women to freeze their eggs in their early 30s. Just because I see a fair number of women who come in at 36 trying to freeze their eggs and they are already plagued by diminished ovarian reserve. So I think it's a very interesting question and there's no consensus in our literature as to when is the best age. I think there is some literature that says that don't freeze your eggs too young if you can avoid it. We know that there are higher rates of chromosome abnormalities at both ends of that reproductive spectrum. So probably wouldn't give my daughter graduating high school, you know, a gift certificate for egg freezing. But I do think that sometime earlier than what's been published to date, I think that's really where it's going to, I think that's where we're going to land is a little bit earlier than 36.
Okay. And Elaine wants to know, what does it mean when your eggs reach a certain size?
I think she may be referring to follicles.
Yes. I bet that's what that
yeah,
is.
Yeah, so when a woman undergoes either an egg freezing cycle or an in vitro fertilization cycle, we monitor the development of the follicles, and follicles are spaces in the ovary where eggs grow and develop. And so on ultrasound, when we look at the very beginning part of a cycle, the follicles tend to be very, very small, so less than 10 millimeters. And we count what's called a resting follicle count, and that tells us generally how many eggs somebody will produce over the course of their IVF cycle. While they're on stimulating medications, women give themselves hormone injections every single day, and then we measure the growth and the development of the follicles. And what we want to see is those follicles getting to be optimally somewhere between 16 and 20 millimeters before we give the final maturation trigger injection.
Oh, okay. I think Elaine followed up with a question, which I think you just answered. What does it mean when your eggs reach a certain size, not quite reaching the optimum size to conceive, then start to shrink?
So sometimes follicles will regress over the course of a cycle. So we don't have a way of really seeing the size of the egg. The egg is microscopic.
Okay.
So when we look on ultrasound, we're not looking at the egg itself. We're looking at the follicle, which is the space where the eggs grow. But sometimes you'll have a follicle that starts out and then it peters out. And that may be what I think you're referring to.
So one thing you just talked about were the injectable medications. Mm-hmm. So one thing that you hear about IVF, and I'm curious if it's true or not, is that IVF involves hundreds of shots in your stomach.
Wow.
So I don't think it's... So, couple.
Do you see those? Do you make like mosaics?
That's multiple cycles worth of medications.
Yeah, that's multiple cycles. So, an average stimulation cycle is 11 days of injections. And depending on the protocol, it's 2 to 3 shots per day. So, about 3 shots per day for the first part of the cycle. So, 33 shots, and it's not in your stomach per se, but it's in that, you know, your love chub or whatever you want to call it, your skin, your subcutaneous tissue that's in your abdomen. And so you just take the needle and you inject it, and it hurts a little. It feels like a little mosquito bite. And then after egg retrieval, depending on the protocol, you may have another shot that's given intramuscularly, typically in the backside, buttocks, or you can use a vaginal suppository. But worst case scenario, if you do 3 shots a day plus progesterone is typically continued for 5 weeks, so 35, about 70, just shy of 70 shots for one IVF cycle, start to finish.
Uh-huh.
And that's worst case scenario.
The psychological factor of, I mean, do people give themselves shots, or your partner gives you a shot, or can you talk a little bit about, I think this is something people are very interested about, and also I'm just curious, IVF in general, like the pain factor.
So I would say that the sub-Q shots, just like Dr. Feinberg mentioned, aren't typically viewed as painful. The IM injections feel more like getting a flu shot in your buttocks each day, but the harder part with the needles definitely is the psychological piece of it. Most of us don't run around giving ourselves injections. And there's lots of people who, you know, really just like needles and or have needle phobia, and so hopefully we have a partner that doesn't have that same anxiety about needles. And typically what our couples will do is one partner will be in charge of the injections and one will be in charge of the setup, the mixing of the medications or getting everything ready to move forward. Sometimes for our single patients, they'll have friends or family members who will give them the injection if they struggle. But most of our patients, even our patients with true needle phobia, are able to work through that and give themselves the injections.
Mm-hmm. All right. That's interesting. Are you seeing more, this is from Andrew, are you seeing more LGBTQ couples coming in, and what are their options?
Yeah.
That's a good question.
So I love our LGBTQ couples, and we see the full spectrum. I recently saw a young male who was transitioning from female to male and wanted to freeze his eggs mm-hmm. prior to transition, and he was 16 and quite a mature, amazing individual. So I think that's on one end of the spectrum. I've had couples, I see a lot of lesbian couples who want to have babies, and they have tons of options. You have, let's tell them I went into OBGYN to take care of women, so it's lovely having 2 women. Like, that's 4 ovaries and 2 yeah. uteruses. It's like a reproductive endocrinologist's dream. And there are lots of different ways that they can get pregnant. They can use donor sperm. I have couples who do reciprocal IVF, where one woman donates the eggs and then the other woman carries the pregnancy.
Oh, that's interesting.
Which is interesting. And then for baby number 2, they can swap.
Uh-huh.
I have some partners or some couples where one just knows, like, she doesn't want to carry, she doesn't want anything to do with it, and the other partner will carry and use a sperm donor. I see same-sex male couples, and that's really, really fun. Again, it's not infertility, it's family building, and so they will use a gestational carrier and an egg donor, and the decision then is whose sperm to use at what point in time. And a lot of my gay couples will want to have 2 babies, 1 from each partner, which is lovely. I see the whole range.
Excellent. All right. here is a fertility statement. You can tell me if it's true or not. This is another one plucked from the many moms group message boards.
Okay.
Holding your legs up for 20 to 30 minutes after you have sex will make it more likely that you conceive. This isn't an infertility question. This is just like if you're having sex with
right.
your partner at home.
Are you in yoga class or just in your bedroom?
like in your bedroom.
No, absolutely not. Yeah. Okay. So I would say position only matters in politics.
Oh, that's a good one. Because people also say position matters for gender.
Yeah, no.
Sperm matters for the sex of a fetus.
Yeah. Okay, myth or fact, my insurance won't pay for any fertility treatments.
In the state of Illinois, it's probably a myth. So we have an insurance mandate in the state of Illinois that if you have an Illinois-based insurance company, if they follow all the various requirements like having more than 25 employees and so on, then your insurance in Illinois probably does cover you. At the same time, we see many couples who live in Illinois whose insurance will not cover them. But more often than not in Illinois, it's worth checking.
Okay.
Yeah.
There are also foundations that are out there that will help to cover the cost of infertility. And mm-hmm. Northwestern is participatory in the Kevin J. Letter Life Foundation. And the Life Foundation will gift either a free IVF cycle or up to $10,000 worth of treatment support for couples with infertility. And that grant cycle is opening this week during National Infertility Awareness Week. So for individuals or couples that don't have any insurance coverage for infertility who need assistance, you can get that information on our website or at lifefindsaway.org.
Great, thank you. We have about 10 minutes left, and you have to get back to clinic, right? So we can't get too much longer past the time. So if you have questions, now is the time. I do have more myths that we can discuss. You can't get pregnant when you're having your period.
Most of the time that's true, but I wouldn't say 100%. First of all, sometimes women will bleed during ovulation, so they think it's a period, but it's really bleeding because the estrogen levels can drop during ovulation. And second, for women that have short menstrual cycles, mm-hmm. but long periods, they may be ovulating day 7 or 8 of their cycle, and they may still be bleeding. So mm-hmm. I would say myth but true.
Okay, how about, what are those called, the ovulation predictor kits? Mm-hmm. Would you recommend if people are like just starting on the fertility journey to purchase one of these?
I just tell people have sex, uh-huh. right? Like, because what I worry about with the ovulation predictor kit is you're going to leave it up to this like flimsy urine kit to tell you when to have a baby or when to have intercourse. And if you're just relying on that one stick to have sex that one time, you're probably going to miss the mark.
Yeah.
I tell all couples have intercourse on days, depending on how long your cycle is, but if you have a 28-day cycle on day 10, 12, 14, and that's it. You can use the ovulation predictor kit to give you information if you're ovulating in the right time, but don't rely solely on that kit to tell you exactly when that one time, because they're just not so reliable.
Same thing with the fertility apps. You don't want to rely solely on the apps to tell you when you are or are not ovulating.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
There's a book, I read it, like, many years ago when I was trying to get pregnant. You probably know what this book is, but it has like you're supposed to take your temperature, engage like your mucus.
Yes.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
All give you during a menstrual cycle, the first half of the cycle is called the follicular phase. The second half of the cycle is called the luteal phase. So follicular phase because the follicle is growing, and then after ovulation that follicle collapses and becomes a corpus luteum. And so the second half is called the luteal phase. That corpus luteum produces progesterone, and progesterone increases your body temperature by like 0.03 degrees. And so you can use basal body temperature to tell you whether or not you've already ovulated.
Oh.
So it's super helpful to say like, yes, no, do I have ovulatory cycles? But if you're relying on that rise in temperature to tell you when to have intercourse, you've missed your mark.
Oh.
You've already ovulated by that point. And cervical mucus, it does have certain patterns. Like during ovulation, it becomes like very stretchy, like the like egg white, that kind of thick, stretchy, mucusy. So again, I think that can be helpful to guide patients to say, okay, like chop chop, let's, you know, let's do our thing. And I think those are important signals to know to get a sense of what your cycles are, but I don't know, it can drive people crazy too.
Yeah. All right, we have a few great questions. Donnie wants to know, I love my copper IUD, but I have concerns about any possible future consequence. Besides the obvious, like PIV, can they cause inflammation that can lead to uterine scarring on their own? If it were to puncture, can that cause scarring that can keep an egg from implanting?
Good question. So IUDs are really, really safe. They cause inflammation while the IUD is in place, largely from the copper, and we think that's part of the mechanism of action. But there is no long-term implication for fertility, and it's a really good method of birth control. The likelihood that an IUD perforates through the uterus, I can't quote the exact likelihood, but it's less than 1 in 1,000. And I think even if it were to perforate through the uterus, these IUDs are so tiny that the likelihood that that would cause permanent infertility is incredibly low.
All right. Megan wants to know, without naming patients' names, what are your favorite success stories?
I don't know where to start.
So I was going to say, it's really hard, but my favorites are the ones who we've been on the journey with them for a long time. They've been struggling before they got to us. They struggle a little bit while they're with us. And then when they ultimately conceive, it truly is like we're a family and we're helping our family members be able to build their families. And it, you know, we've shed many happy tears and many sad tears with our patients because we're on the journey with them.
I need a whole Facebook Live. I have one couple that just comes to the top of my mind where we did an egg retrieval. We got 10 eggs, but only one fertilized. Mm-hmm. And we had to keep that little embryo frozen for a year because this patient's sister was going to be her gestational carrier. And her sister had had a baby, and so we had to wait for her sister to finish breastfeeding, and her sister lived out of state, and her sister flew, and we weren't sure if that one embryo was going to survive, and it did, and their daughter is now 5 years old.
Aww.
It's just like, so I'm friends with a lot of my patients on Facebook, and I get to see the kids grow up, and it's amazing. Like, I love what I get to do.
Uh-huh. That's awesome. All right. Back to the myth or fact. Going dairy or gluten-free increases your chance of a successful IVF cycle. I found it on the internet.
So if you have celiac disease, yes. And if you have unexplained infertility, there's some data that says that a certain percentage of patients who have unexplained infertility have celiac disease. So that's something that I do test for when I see a couple that has unexplained infertility. I will check antibodies, usually against anti-gliadin antibodies, to check for the presence of celiac disease. In the absence of celiac disease, I am not at all convinced that going gluten-free, dairy-free, I mean, our patients already go gluten-free, dairy-free, caffeine-free, right, alcohol-free, sex-free sometimes. Like, we take all the fun out of their lives. Yeah. So I'm like, eat your pizza, enjoy it. Yeah. Like, there's no data to show truly that gluten or dairy impacts fertility rate.
And the one thing that I would say with all of these myths, whether it's dietary, whether it's stress, whether it's acupuncture, is that when we share these myths with our friends or family members, even though we're not trying to do this, in effect, we could be blaming that person. And I think that these myths contribute to why so many women and men don't talk about infertility and don't talk about miscarriage, and instead suffer in silence because they're afraid if they say that they're experiencing infertility, if they say that they've had a miscarriage, is somebody gonna say to them, well, what did you do?
Right, and to follow up on that, we do have another question, so I'm gonna make this quickly. Can you both or each say, you know, if somebody knows somebody going through infertility, mm-hmm, like what would be a helpful thing to say? Like people are trying to be helpful, so they'll say, well, why don't you just adopt, you get pregnant, but as pointed out earlier, that's actually not very helpful. So what would something helpful to say or to do?
So the thing that I would suggest is asking them how you can help. Rather than starting by giving advice, ask them how they're doing. Ask them if there's anything that you can do to support them along the way. If nothing else, just, you know, sitting with somebody in their pain when they're sad that things are not working out the way that they want can be profoundly helpful to someone else.
Yeah, I always tell people to get a sense of, do they want their friends and family to check in with them, or do they want silence? And some patients, it's like, don't ask me a question, I'll tell you when I'm 20 weeks pregnant. Mm-hmm. And some patients get very hurt that their family and friends aren't constantly checking in. So I always tell my patients, know what type of a person you are. Like, are you somebody that wants frequent, like, check-ins and hugs, or you want somebody, are you somebody that just wants total stealth silence? And then communicate that
right.
to your family and friends and tell them, like, don't ask me, I'll tell you, or hey, I need like TLC.
Right. Oh, that's good. Okay. I apologize if I mispronounce your first name. Lakahaya wants to know, what about the Depo-Provera shot? Does that cause infertility in the future?
Nope.
All right.
I mean, it may cause irregular cycles. So Depo is not completely out of your system for 18 months, but it does not cause long-term infertility at all.
What, and what is that? You get a shot and then 18 months. It lasts for 18 months?
Well, the Depo-Provera shot actually just lasts for 3 months, and you have to have a subsequent shot every 3 months to maintain contraceptive efficacy. But there have been studies that have shown that menstrual cycles may continue to be irregular for up to 18 months after discontinuation.
All right. I think we're about out of time. Anything else you'd like to add?
Just that I think it's really important for us to support everyone who's experiencing infertility and loss in a non-judgmental and open way. Let's get rid of the stigma. There's no need for it.
Yeah.
That's great. And again, National Infertility Awareness Week starts on the... Lakahaya says thank you. So thank you for that. It starts August 22nd, which is Sunday.
Yeah.
Or April 22nd, which is Sunday. So if you are interested in learning more about Northwestern medicine, fertility and reproductive medicine, this might be the time to look into it a little bit more. Fertility.nm.org is the website, and the number to call is 312-695-7269. To the one, all very friendly and warm and welcoming people here. So these are just two of them, but they've got a whole staff full of terrific people that are looking to help you build the family that you have been wishing for. Okay, and also just a plug for their FRM TV, which is monthly on their Facebook page, facebook.com/Northwestern Medicine FRM. So on the Northwestern Medicine Facebook page you're looking at now, you'll find fertility news, but you'll find even more fertility news, as well as some nice stories. I see patients post stuff over there, you know, pictures of their kids and stuff like that. So it's kind of a very sweet place to be. So log into that as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Both of you.
Thank you.
This is a pleasure.
Yeah, thanks for having us.